Welcome everyone to Mobile Portland. I'm Jason with Bus 4. We've got a few things, just a little logistics, and actually shorter than normal because things have been really hectic, so I don't have the events calendar like I normally would. Going to go through some introductions, take care of a couple things, and then dive right into the presentation. Just a quick couple of notes about Mobile Portland. We meet on a monthly basis, the fourth Monday of every month, 6 p.m. right here. We talk about a variety of topics, so I'm not sure what we're going to do next month. I know it looks like August is going to be education. We're going to be talking about mobile and in school settings, in college and high school, so that looks like it's going to be really interesting. And if you're not signed up yet, you can sign up for one of two mailing lists, either mobileformula.com, there's an announcement mailing list, or there's a Google group. There are also some other groups that meet once a month. There's a pantry group that meets the second Monday of every month. There's a iPhone group that meets the second Tuesday of every month. Is that correct?
First
Tuesday. Always get that wrong. And Poets Bridge is coming up. There are a couple of presentations related to mobile there. And that's in June, correct? Sean, is that correct?
Yeah, June 2nd, 3rd, and 4th.
June 2nd, 3rd, 4th. Sean's presenting on Android. And OSCON is coming up in July. There's actually a pretty good mobile track on OSCON this year.
The
different
groups on Monday.
That would be a good thing to do. I can't promise that unless somebody wants to volunteer to help.
Most of this stuff is on calculator.
Okay. See, it's already on the website. It's just not the mobile part of the website. Yeah, good point. So I'm going to pass it over to Renaun in just 1 second. But actually, I was thinking recently that we could take this opportunity to sort of like do research at these meetings and sort of ask questions of the audience real briefly. So I thought, you know, in between now and the next meeting, if people have questions that they want to sort of poll developers, I collect them and then just maybe take like a couple minutes at the beginning of each meeting and do that. So first, primary device, iPhone, raise your hand. Okay, Android. BlackBerry? Windows Mobile, anyone? All right.
Palm?
WebOS, Palm, or great. No. Nokia? Or Nokia? As I like to say, no. Okay, how many people carry more than one phone? All right. And so we're still in America. Another question that I had was, if you think about your phone and the number of apps that you download on your phone, right, that didn't come with your phone, how many of them you use on a daily basis? So let's start. If you have one app that you use every day, raise your hand.
At least one or just one?
At least one. Okay. And the same app. Okay. And then keep your hands up. Okay. 5 or more? Okay, 10 or more? Not interesting. Okay, that's kind of what I thought. I've been thinking about like the number of apps that people use and like how much repetition there is in it. Because people keep talking about apps as being a barrier to switching handsets, and I'm not sure. So that's just the research portion. So if you have questions for next month, because those were just the questions that were on my mind, send them to me and we'll do this next month and see what comes out of it. So I'm very, very happy to have Renaun here to talk. Last week, if you missed it, at Google I/O, there were a ton of announcements related to Android and Flash and AIR, and there's a beta out now that actually looks very cool. And Steve Jobs can suck it or whatever. So it was. Yeah. I get it out of the way on his behalf. So Renaun is an evangelist at Adobe and is here from.
Watch the Google I/O.
with us releasing our Adobe runtimes for the Android devices, and that's kind of what we're talking about. It's these two new releases, Flash 13.1 here too, which is our latest releases, and they are not fully released, but they are both in public beta.
Similar stuff.
whiteboarding and multi-user environment, help lifecycle data, communication services. If you guys have any questions, feel free to interrupt me at any time and let me know. There's a different group here. Let me know if you have questions about specific stuff. Then we have servers, Flash Media Server, which does a lot of the media stuff, but also, if you haven't used it, does interactivity. So if you want a multi-user application, you can use Flash Media Server. And then Adobe Lifecycle Data Services, more for the heavy, rich internet applications that need persistence of data across multiple applications. And that gives you a whole another set of stack that is more in the Java world and lets you scale and gives you a whole bunch of management stuff. So the two runtimes, the Flash Player is here just for the browser, and it's a browser plugin. So it lives within the browser and has to live by that. That actually has caused a lot of problems because the browser is one of the weakest links there. If the OS and the browser doesn't support something or doesn't allow us to do something, we don't get to do it. And then what we did is we went after AIR, killed the bricks, kind of go past that beyond the browser and build, allow people to take their same skills that they've used to build stuff for the web, so just not Flash, but also JavaScript and HTML. And with those same skill sets, you can build an AIR application which will run on the desktop. And then in the mobile sense, what that means is standalone applications. So we're actively going after these two runtimes, both on the desktop and the runtime. One's for all the plugins on the browsers, and the other one is for, you know, beyond the browser, standalone applications, desktop applications. And where this comes, so FlashPlayer 10.1 and 2.0 has really, we've really looked at this little, you guys also know about this, everything's going mobile, it's basically the same. And the other tidbit is, it's not just about PC, so it's and not mobile, but right now it's the mobile's the big thing, and it will be continuing the big thing, but there's these other devices. You see how quickly the tablets, you know, become popular, even though we had tablet devices, you know, 10 years ago. I remember seeing them at school at the time, but they weren't the same. Now we're actually seeing that where people are actually using stuff across multiple screens. So Adobe going after this, all these different platforms has been core to us for a while, but it's really getting the critical mass of this becoming important. So this release, FlashPlayer 2.1 and 2.0, was really geared towards making this happen. And what we do in Adobe has a, we have a project called the Open Screen Project. And these are all the partners, and there's actually more than these. But pretty much everybody except one company is on board. We have the technology partners, so things like Intel, and working with them closely, and Qualcomm on some of the, you know, H2Bit Access H2.6 encoders. At Max last year, NVIDIA, we showed the Tegra 2 stuff where they, you know, 1080p video with hardware delivered with NVIDIA on really small devices. And so a lot of cool things coming out of these guys working with us to make our runtimes work really well. On the same token, we get a lot of content providers that are interested in how we're moving forward with this. So first I'm going to talk about Flash Player 10.1, that's the features, and I'll show some demos. So with this release, we really just didn't target the desktop. Stuff, you know, we talked about Android. So all of our runtimes run on Windows, Mac, and Linux. And before Linux was always lacking, but currently Linux is released with everything. So Linux does have 10.1, or it is up to 10 now, so about 10.1. I had the ones over there in the black, because, you know, we've probably talked about RAM and Palm OS, but they're not out yet. Android was just announced last week, and Nokia's already had Flash Player 10 for a while, actually a year or 2 years. But they will get 10.1. So their RIM and Palm will be on will be in the future. They're just currently not out, but we've publicly talked about that. And our shift has been, before we had a technology that was geared towards devices and really took off outside of the US. So we actually have Flash technology on billions of devices. Billions, not just millions, but billions of devices. But mostly that was the Flash Lite stuff, mostly in Japan and in Europe. And so currently, you know, we're changing that where our main Flash Player that has all the features is really geared for all these upper tier devices. And we'll still have Flash enabled lower end devices, but we changed our pricing, now it's all open and all this different stuff. So we really geared towards that, we're pushing for that every new device will be on these, on the full Flash Player runtime. So currently, like, if you have a Droid Incredible, you actually have Flash Lite on it already, and you can actually already see a lot of Flash content. But when the Flash 2 and get it on there, then you'll have all the feature stuff. But Flashlight 4 actually has a lot of, you can see quite a lot of content. So we've been working on this runtime quite a bit, and there's been a lot of work in a lot of different areas. So we have things, and it's kind of funny because people complain about the performance of the runtime, but there's actually a good post that it's hard to compare Flash runtime to other things. Yeah, there's crap out there that people build crappy code, you know, put a loop on some app that shouldn't be there, but you know, people can make bad stuff. But in general, if you're building a heavy media or content heavy application, it is gonna, you know, take some CPU cycles. But we've gone back and actually made this make sense in the mobile and constrained devices environment by, you know, tapping into the hardware acceleration, using the audio and video decoding when possible. Went back and did memory and battery CPU optimizations. It was also on the developer side, when you guys publish your Swift, we give you the option to handle better how all that Swift stuff management. So if you have 5 Swifts on a web page, somebody hits that, you can actually have control of the priority on which Swift can run, or you know, run at all, or if it's lagging. So there's some priority there, and you can kind of manage your Swifts. And then sleep mode, you know, our Swifts will kind of basically kind of go into sleep mode. They'll run really, really slow, so they won't eat up your CPU if your phone screen goes away. So we spent a lot of time making the paradigm of the mobile and these constrained devices make sense for runtimes. And then just the other stuff that has to be there. I mean, most of these mobile phones don't have keyboards, so mobile text input. We've also reached out to all the open screen project partners, so they have access to this stuff, and we work closely with them. Multi-touch, gestures, accelerometer, screen orientation. These are all new features with this release that are mobile specific. And then just down here, just in the runtime performances, without changing from, we've had people talk, report that their applications are not changing anything in their content, or you get, you know, performance boosts in CPU and memory consumption. So none of that. So more specifically on the optimization stuff, if you've ever embedded a Swift into a web page, you have the embed tag, and you have a lot of actions on it. So now we have this new HTML parameter called has priority, and with that has priority, you can define, you know, the priority levels and the different ones. But then we also do other things, because a lot of people use Flash apps on their pages to do little helper Swifts, like file upload or some other little things that are in the background. So we also prioritize those ourselves, so, you know, the ones that are actually showing stuff will pull up first, and I'll has priority on the screen and all that different things. And then what we'll do is, like, either if the device runs out of memory or something, it'll just stop loading the other ones. So we have a lot of logic in there to handle a lot of these situations to keep your phone from basically croaking.
Is there any user-based management of that? I mean, like,
so that's more device-specific, but what will happen is, so no, the developer has to set this up, and then like, so we have, no, if that's more like, you know, Firefox okay. Plugin that allows you to click and play then. And unless somebody builds that on that side, that's the way the client will. We're making it so the developer can do this smartly. And then also, you know, the Swifts are not on the visible part of your screen. They also won't load and all that stuff. So it automatically does them all for you that the user would want to do. Right. So a lot of, you know, 90% of it is pretty much done. Okay. Of course, there will always be those people that want nothing to run until they click on it, so.
Yeah. I'm sorry, when you said that they don't load on the screen, if they're off screen.
If they're off screen, they won't load up.
They don't initiate, or they don't actually load the data?
So there's a couple things. If it's really gone all the way where the resources are used up, you'll do the click and play thing, so it won't load at all, it won't initialize at all. So okay, you'll have those cases, and then just if they're not on the screen, no, they won't play.
They won't play, but they also won't. Will the content be loaded? I mean, will it increase the size of the website?
So yeah, no. I don't know. That's more of a browser mechanism, because it depends on the browser if they pull it down. I assume the browser will pull all content down just to play. So I don't see why a browser wouldn't pull everything down. Unless the browser is smart enough, do they do that with images? If they do that with images, I mean, Swifts are basically content, so if they're treated the same way. I don't know that much about the mobile browser, so if the browsers do that, they would do it. So mobile-specific features, I kind of talked about most of those. The big one here is, this is going to become important. So now we expose anything that the Flash player can do actually has some limitations because some devices don't support everything. Not all devices have a microphone. Not all devices have a camera. Things like that. So, you know, they might not have a virtual keyboard. They might. All these things now we expose to the capabilities object. And so you can figure this out as a developer and write your app to be adapted to all those capabilities.
Is there any mapping of things like mouse over events to something else?
No, but what we do is we always fire that. So it just happens that, you know, there is no, you know, you really don't multi-touch, you don't have a mouse over.
I know.
So when you push it down, because a lot of people still, Flash content has that. When you push it down, it'll move the mouse down, mouse over, and the mouse up really, really quickly. So all the events still get fired, it just happens really quick. So all existing content will still work. It's not broken. And that was a big thing that came up, but that worked. Of course, the person has some weird stuff in there. It might be a little weird, but their code will fire off. Other features. So these are not mobile specific, but with this dot release, we also have some important stuff. We actually have better support for localization. So this is the case where you have locale stuff. So if your application is running on a Chinese person's website and they want to have a date format in a different format, you can base it on their actual system and pull from their local system local stuff. And so this API now does that. You didn't really have that before. You had to do it kind of on the runtime or in your application itself. Also, finally support global error handling. So for the longest time, we have events bubble up, and you can never catch those things. So if you were running a debug player, you could see them as a developer. Now you can actually catch that, regardless of where it bubbles up. Microphone access. That one's cool. I actually wrote it. I'll show you a demo with this stuff. But I recently joined Evangelist, but this is another project I worked on last year. So you have access to the microphone raw bytes. So locally, so you don't have to go to a server to actually pull them. So you can, somebody can be talking locally, you can pull those bytes, they're sort of PCM data, and you can do fun things with it. I'll show you a little bit of that. The media enhancements, Flash Access was actually announced about 2-3 weeks right before Google I/O. And so we've kind of had to bend towards all the people out there that want their content restricted. And so this Flash Access is a new rev of this, and we work with a lot of the big content people and the technology people to do things. So we've added, you know, HTML video streaming that everyone wants, and R2FP groups is our P2P stuff. But with those two things, we now with Flash Access give the content people, the developers, to kind of control anywhere the videos are displayed. So if you have to restrict your video to run only on one display and not be able to go up on this external display and come up like on a big screen, you can actually restrict that. Crazy DRM, I don't care for DRM, but this is where everything is, the critical point where everything's going, and a lot of the heated discussion around HTML5 video, Silverlight and Flash, you know, this is why Flash won't die. So there's a lot of use cases, not us personally use cases, but a lot of big money use cases for this stuff. So it's there.
Could you just explain that statement? It seemed pretty
significant about it. So HTML5 doesn't do any DRM.
No DRM.
Yeah, so like Hulu. So you'll see on Android, if you get the Flash Player 10.1, this is the perfect use case, Flash Player 10.1, you get the Flash Player on there, go to Hulu, and you can't see the content. It has nothing to do about technology, it has nothing to do about Android or Flash or anything, it has everything to do about Hulu's license of the content. Hulu's license of the content doesn't allow them to play videos on mobile. So they restrict that. So there's a hack where you do go into your mobile browser and say, I'm not a mobile, I'm a desktop, and then you watch it. So it has nothing to do with the technology.
Just get away.
And you'll see more of that, more restricted. So, you know, we talk about open video and all this stuff, but there's a world out there that's not YouTube, so even YouTube has licensing restrictions, but not as bad as like the Hulu situation.
Has that changed at all from the original Flash Access? Because that was previously only available on Air, right? Now it's gonna be.
So this was announced just a couple weeks ago. This is AIR and Flash Player.
Right. Yeah. And so, but the access itself is the same thing that you had in the first version, just now in the player two.
This is a rewrite of that. I don't know what you're talking about. There was some early DRM stuff with RTMP. It's totally different.
No, they had the access for AIR actually, okay. Right?
Probably because that made it that revision. I haven't followed up on this. I just know it was announced and being released with Flash Player 10.1 and AIR 2. All the content people will be And if you're a content publisher and want access to that stuff, you can talk to me after. It's a whole different, you know, world at Adobe, but it is a big deal. So basically, with these features, with 10.1, gives us a part, everything that's overlaid, everything that everybody else is asking for with DRM and HTTP video streaming. So kind of back to your point, a lot of this multi-touch and some of the mouse over, specifically how this works is you can decide, so devices don't necessarily give you gestures or even multi-touch raw events, so you have to know your devices, and that's where that capabilities comes in. But depending on the device and how many points they offer, you can either get them as just raw touch points, you know, wherever the points are, the pressure, and if they give you pressure and information, we'll even pass that up to you. Or you can do gestures like the two finger swipe and the pinch and zoom and all that stuff. So you as a developer can choose how you want to do your application and get that data back. But we also, no matter if you choose to use one of those or not, we always give you the mouse events. So the mouse down and the mouse up stuff. So you can still, all the existing content will work. And then if you make your app and don't have a device that actually uses multi-touch, you can fall back and write your code to also catch mouse events, and it will still work for the stuff you want to do. So, you know, talked about content working, so I'm actually going to show you demos on Flash Player 10.1. And looks like the Wi-Fi went away, so I'll make sure you back up. So, this is going to be kind of hard because I think I'm quite prepared with the good video cam. So, I'll show it both ways. Show it on this. So, what I have here is, let me show up. Is there a way to dim these lights up here? Video, I can go full screen.
running on the request.
That's quality. I mean, if you sat around and just watched stuff, like...
Yeah, most of it, if it's, so the funny thing is some if you go to a site that has a high bit rate, and this is 800 by 480 pixels, sometimes it'll be jerky just like it would on anything. A lot of times that's my Wi-Fi though, but I mean, quality-wise, it looks just good. Actually, it looks pretty cool on it if they have a high bit rate. This is a high density LED screen, so things will look really cool on this. So if they have the quality and the bit rate, you'll see it.
How does Flex framework stuff?
I'll get to that. I'll show you. It actually works pretty easy, pretty good on these devices. And it's mostly the CPU and the RAM is the issue. But I have more of those on the Air. Let me see if I actually have. So you mean things like Google Finance? You know, this is not mobile optimized. And if you ever use Google Finance, they have the their stock thing is actually Flash. So this works. You can zoom in, all that stuff. This changes, so it's like interacting with the JavaScript and changing the news and all that stuff. So that works. I'll show you one that's kind of more like my 3-year-old likes. And this is to really show you the content that just works. So my kid likes Starfall. You guys see Starfall? It's for learning your ABCs and different things. So
what if I hold your laptop up so I can see it so you can see it?
Yeah.
And then they can see the screen?
Maybe.
Let's try that. You turn so you can see. Cool, so you can see. And I'll try it. Not like this.
You turn.
There you go. That way. So you can see.
And I'll try it, but I'll try to find this. Make it you can see. Nice. So this is Flash content that hasn't been optimized, and it's you can start with the browser mechanism so you can zoom out and zoom in. You know, it doesn't do anything, and you double tap to go back to the regular site. But this is all interacting with it. But the cool thing is, I'll show you.
Is that any better than him doing it?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Well, I'll tag out.
I need a new laptop anyway. I'm going to get to a point in this thing. So my 3-year-old, he doesn't know the mouse mechanism very well on the desktop. He hasn't quite figured it out. But on this, when I actually give him this device, really catchy. Okay, so this one right here with the mouse, he doesn't learn how to do the whole drag and drop and everything and all that stuff. But on this, it's very intuitive. He just takes his finger and drags it down to the basket. So the cool thing about this new wave is everything is a lot more, the touch is a lot more intuitive to people that have never had to learn about certain desktop input device mechanisms. So he actually gets this.
This is great.
Okay. So.
So when you give them to play with on the hard drive, you have to listen to that the whole way?
Thank you.
these things walk around, but what we can do is you can actually go pick your monster. And then you play these matches.
So basically, and I'm not sure how they did this, but this is pretty cool Flash content.
Yeah.
And it actually runs on this device, so that's what I was going to show you. So, fucking loser. Oops. Oh, come on, get him. I died. I used all my attacks, and I'm going to die now. I think I hit it, whatever. Cool, so with this running on the. So now I pick my monster. And if you do want
branding doesn't go away, but you have full capability of targeting a specific platform and having, you know, bundle anything you want with it and do whatever you want. We also added support for server sockets. So Flash itself only can create a socket as a client and talk to a server. But with AIR, you can actually create server sockets, UDP and TCP. And we also did better integration with like hooking your USB drive in it, and it'll pick that up. We've had issues with that before, but that now works. So a lot of storage devices and USB integration. With the new networking APIs and those RTMP features, now you can build applications in AIR that are a lot more sophisticated, like VoIP applications with microphone access and the server socket stuff, or peer-to-peer stuff. So AIR, you know, with the networking gives you a lot more capabilities than the Flash player, which doesn't allow that, mostly because of the browser sandboxing. So with this release, AIR becomes a little more complicated to explain. But if you understand what it's trying to do, it actually, you just got to know the different complexities of it, and it gives you a lot of power. So in the first release, it would always turn into an AIR file. So the .AIR file up there, Adobe Integrated Runtime. And with that, the AIR file would be able to be installed on Mac, Windows, or Linux, and you'd have one runtime with, you know, well, the runtimes for those OSs would run that one application. And you can build the application through Flash Pro with Flex or with JavaScript or HTML. And why that was capable is AIR, its runtime, has everything that Flash Player has in it. We also included SQLite, so you have a full database inside of AIR. You build your application that has a database. And we put the WebKit engine in there, and that's where the HTML and JavaScript comes in. And then we just give you hooks into any of the APIs that the Flash Player does, like accessing the microphone and other things. And so in HTML, you can just do AIR dot whatever and access the framework. So the cool thing, though, that's not really talked about much more is in the Flash world, in the browser, a lot of times you want to do HTML over it or do some funny things. But since WebKit is a native component inside of the AIR runtime, which basically Flash, you can build Flash, well, HTML pages that live in your Flash, and then do anything you can do in Flash with it. So you can rotate it, fade it, blend it, stretch it, have anything and everything overlap on it. So just that alone, you can do some very interesting applications. And you can have multiple HTML controls and just mix and match, transparency, and all that fun stuff. So with AIR 2, we allowed these native, these packages is not the best term, but building stuff for specific platforms. So you can build a native application for EXE, we bundle everything in that, the DNG, like I explained. And so we take the same approach on some of these, partnering with the devices. So when you build an Android app with AIR, it bundles it up as an APK, and what that gives us is now an APK can live where Android apps live, so the Android marketplace. And it knows how to handle all devices that know how to handle an APK, handles it the same way. If you, somebody goes to go and grab your APK that's an AIR app and don't have a runtime, it would be the same experience like on the web and or the desktop right now. It would say, go get the runtime, and it will, and how Android does that with apps that have linkage like that, you know, it would go pull it off the Android marketplace and install it for you. So the same simple mechanisms that are typical for that would still apply here. Now, I do have some disclaimers because of these early releases and certain things. The AIR runtime on Android is somewhat limited, and there's reasons for this. Some of it's device reasons, and some of it's OS reasons, device and manufacturers, and some of it's just this is the first release and we haven't gotten everything. So things like bundling a WebKit inside the AIR runtime when most mobile phones already have a WebKit doesn't make sense. So on the first version, we didn't get that. That might change in the future, but it didn't make sense in the first version. So that means you can't build an AIR app that's targeted towards Android and JavaScript or HTML. And because most of mobile devices, if you're doing that, you'd already be doing it in the browser or whatnot. You still have the SQLite. There is some other things that are bumped out, but those things will change over time because this is the early release, and we'll add more features. And I've seen some things internally, and I don't see a problem with this really. I just have to make this statement, so if you actually go download it and play with it, I want to make you aware of some of those issues and decisions.
So is the idea there that since you already have WebKit local, you can develop an application kind of in reverse. So you use your own WebKit and embed the Flash that you're creating.
So you'd have, like, a lot of the mechanism of the mobile is different than the desktop. So a lot of times you could easily integrate, like, your sending application to pop out to a web page. And then that would just use the standard browser on the device, and then you come back.
Right. So you can
come back.
Okay, that's yeah. what I'm asking.
And I can show you an app that does that. Yeah. So you just don't get that whole capability of, like, embedding an HTML control and doing funky things with it. But, you know, how many people are actually going to do that on a mobile device? And in the future, we might see that come out, but this first version, it didn't make sense at all from our perspective with the manufacturers and devices. You know, we just didn't want to go there right now. There's too much. Everything's up in the air right now with a lot of stuff. So does that make sense? Any other questions about that? Yep.
Are there particular SDK versions that it does or doesn't support with Android or something?
No, so just the OS.
Oh, yeah, so our SDK.
Yeah, so with AIR, it's actually 2.1. With Flash Player, it's 2.2 because Froyo had some specific stuff on the OS of the browser and stuff. But with AIR, we have it running on Declare, so 2.1 is not above.
Okay.
So that one's more easier to play with. And both these will have links at the end that you can go get these go and get access to these and play with it. Cool. Any other questions? No, let's show you the demos. Actually, what I wanted to show you first was some AIR 2 desktop demos. Before I show you the mobile one. So the microphone one. So this is the local microphone access. So I would say, hello, mobile Portland, yada yada yada. Then you have raw access, so you have access to this. So if I play this back, I can actually slow this down, speed it up, all real time, do fun things, you know. And then what I can do is actually, I wrote this so it would actually save whatever setting it was on. So I can click this button and actually save out the file, and it will, and it's playing back because it actually told the OS it will play that WAV file, and it was all fast, and I actually picked it up to my iTunes, so my iTunes was playing that, so that's why you heard that.
Is that only an AIR feature, or, I mean, I'm obviously working from the desktop, but do you have a web page to do that same thing now with 10.1?
No. That's an AIR feature hooked into the OS to pass it a file and say...
Oh, no, I just mean the recording.
Yeah, the recording, the microphone access is also in 10.1.
Right. Would it let you, like, pump you save it locally? Or
no, you still have the restrictions of saving files and that. So you'd have to use server round trip or another application to talk to it to load it or save it. So you can't save. Yeah, FlashBlur doesn't allow you to save locally. So that kind of shows you some of the AIR 2 features. If you haven't used AIR, this is a Chromeless app. And then this other app I'm going to show you. So AIR, you have full integration. So this actually uses the native OS stuff. So if I install this on Windows, this up here would look just like a Windows buttons. And so you have it's really a desktop application. And the same thing applies for mobile devices. So most of the time you won't be using the Chrome of an OS. You'd be writing an app that just lives by itself in the custom Chrome. But it knows how to act like an app, just like these apps know. If they're on Windows, they look like a certain app and all that stuff. That's what AIR does for you. So in this example, what I have is, this is an AIR application that's using the server socket stuff, and it's gonna register a socket, and then I'm gonna use Bonjour, basically. I'm actually gonna use the multicast DNS from Apple to have this application, which is an AIR application, find this application, link up, and then I'm going to send all the multi-touch and the accelerator over to it. It's not the IP of this thing. So I just start that server, and so you can guess what the device this is, but this is the only device I have that has a lot of multi-touch points. So I went ahead and found that guy and just have full text here. But what I do is I hit one of my little application buttons, and this is for multi-touch. So then this sends all the multi-touch data over. So that's kind of cool. So then with AIR 2, with all these new features, you have all, you know, access to sockets, servers, and all that fun stuff. And just to show you that the endpoints actually work nicely, so it's over. So nothing cool, just, you know, sending fun stuff over to your desktop. So you'll see a lot of people building controllers on their iPhone. I mean, you've seen them already, but just so AIR 2 can do this stuff too, so you can build some really fun stuff with it.
So, Renaun?
Yep.
With stuff that's like going through enterprise, like with Apple, you could ship stuff like this if you were building. If you didn't go through the App Store.
But you have the provisioning issues. Like it only lasts so long, but you have the ad hoc, which you know.
Well, I was thinking actually specifically about enterprise, like large businesses being able to self-sign stuff for their employees.
Don't they still have the provisioning issue, where your provision only lasts so long? So you could use this technology, use it internally, never make the Apple Store all work, but you have that provisioning issue and other stuff. So is that your question?
Yeah, I thought that the provisioning issue, like, because it was, if you were doing enterprise distribution, you could really do business license, doesn't matter.
Okay, I don't know, I've never done enterprise, my app on the App Store is, you know, I've only just personally, so I don't know anything about an enterprise provision. I always thought there was the ad hoc, the distribution one.
There's ad hoc through the App Store, and then there's enterprise.
Okay.
I think you're right, Jason. I think it goes that way.
As long as it doesn't hit the App Store, and they don't have to approve it, yeah. If this makes an IPA, you can distribute it however you want. If you sign it with that provision, that works however the IPA would live, and yeah. Yep. So yeah, I would say have fun with it, because it's actually was really fun to build, since I have the, you know, my skill set, to use my skill set to quickly build stuff for this was like, that was a Flex app, and I whipped that up really quick and sent socket data over it, and that was pretty cool, so I didn't have to do a lot of crazy stuff. So assuming you want to come help me,
yeah.
Show these air apps on this. The price is right. Oh, wait, set this up again.
Yeah, I'm totally unprepared.
Just one more, any less cable.
News, so here's the example, it going off the web page, picking up the news, and then going going back to the application. So there's all that integration.
I was in Facebook for a while and I to affect your
ColdFusion.
Is that the guy who handed it to you?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So he came back.
I thought he was dead. No, he just didn't come back.
First Lego League.
First Lego League.
First.
First.
So they